It's estimated that seatbelts have collectively saved over 1 million lives, making them one of the most cost-effective public health inventions ever made. These incredible devices can reduce fatalities in car accidents by about half. Yet, their development and implementation as standard equipment was surprisingly rocky. For something that seems so straightforward, the humble seatbelt is more sophisticated than you might think. Even though wearing a restraint in a vehicle moving 100 kilometers per hour may seem like common sense to us today, it took many years to convince the driving public to buckle up, a problem that persists in many countries around the world. This ingenious device saves lives, and this is how it does it. In 1903, race car driver Barney Oldfield became the first person to drive over 100 kilometers per hour. He was all too aware of the dangers he was subjecting himself to and commissioned Leslie Leroy Irvin, another daredevil of the 1920s, to develop a harness for his racing cars. Irvin had developed his own static line parachute to jump out of airplanes, and in 1919 became the first American to jump out of a plane and manually deploy a parachute from a backpack in midair. The harness they came up with did not catch on, however. Despite its life-saving potential, it had a number of problems. First, they were simply uncomfortable, which discouraged drivers and passengers from wearing them. Then, there was the very real problem of seatbelt syndrome, injuries directly related to wearing a seatbelt during a collision. Early seatbelts only went across the lap. In the event of a crash, this rigid, single-point restraint, laying in line with vital organs and the lumbar spine, could cause severe injuries. The prevailing thought at the time was that it would be better to be ejected from the vehicle, which might catch on fire or go underwater, than to remain inside of it during a crash by being stopped forcefully by a thin piece of fabric. Despite rising fatalities and injuries during the rise of the automobile from the 1920s and 1950s, the general public showed little interest in wearing seatbelts. Even though Nash Motors installed seatbelts in 40,000 cars, only about 1,000 of them were actually used by drivers. When Ford led a marketing campaign in 1955 to promote seatbelts and other safety options, they too faced public backlash. However, in the 1950s, resistance began to ebb away with a new innovation by Swedish engineer Niels Bohlin. Bohlin first began developing features for Saab, including an ejection seat, but was then poached by the president of Volvo. He experimented with several designs, including a seatbelt that fastened between the legs, an idea which 95% of my audience just gasped at. He ultimately settled on the design we're familiar with today, the three-point harness. This setup more evenly distributes the forces of a crash across the shoulders and hips. Bohlin was able to prove the effectiveness of this design and received the US patent for it in 1962, but rather than profit from it, the design was released for free, paving the way for a new and incredibly important safety feature. While certain elements of the seatbelt have been modified and improved over time, the main design remains the same. We need a way for the strap itself to wind and unwind under normal circumstances, allowing passengers to easily move around and take it on and off without adjusting its size for different passengers and drivers. We have all experienced that annoying phenomenon where you try to put on a seatbelt too quickly, causing it to jam. This happens as a result of a false alarm in the seatbelt mechanism. This mechanism. It has a number of components, the simplest being the spiral torsion spring. When the seatbelt is unwound, it spins a cylinder at the center of this torsion spring, pulling the spring into the center into a compressed state, storing energy that can retract the seatbelt tightly against your body once the belt buckle is locked into the buckle socket. This mechanism is usually attached to one side of the webbing spool, while the locking mechanism that will prevent the spool from being unwound at all during a crash is located on the other side. For this mechanism to work, we need a way to detect a crash extremely quickly. One kind of locking mechanism reacts to the momentum change of the vehicle. Just as our bodies want to continue moving forward in a crash, a weighted mechanism inside the seatbelt will too. First, we need a ratchet gear, like this. attached to the same cylinder at the center of our torsion spring. This gear will be engaged to prevent rotation. Now, we need a mechanism that can engage this gear when the car decelerates. This can be done with a weighted pendulum. When the car decelerates, this weight will swing forward, causing its opposite end to jam into the ratchet, preventing it from rotating any further. Like any good safety mechanism, there is a redundancy in its design, being backed up by another locking mechanism, one you can test without crashing your car. By tugging on your seatbelt hard enough, this mechanism will activate, as it depends on centrifugal force to activate. Two weighted levers are attached to the central spool. When the central spool unwinds at a normal speed, these levers do not create enough force to overcome the force of a spring that pushes them towards the center. But if the webbing comes out in a sudden jerk, the centrifugal force exceeds the force of the spring and the levers push outwards, engaging the locking teeth and preventing further rotation. There is another safety mechanism added to make seatbelts even safer. When driving, we often slump forward slightly, leaving slack between our body and the seat. In the event of a crash, it's best if we are tightly held against the seat. So, there is a mechanism within the seatbelts that actually forcefully pulls us against the seat during a crash. This mechanism is fired electronically by the same sensor that initiates the explosion that expands airbags. This mechanism is also fired by an explosive charge. It's called the pretensioner. A chamber at the bottom of the device has two electrodes, an igniter material, and a piston. When the car's central processor detects a collision, it applies an electric current that ignites the explosive, and the sudden burst of pressure forces a mechanism to actuate, to quickly retract the seatbelt and pull the passenger tightly against the seat. Finally, the seatbelt has several mechanisms built in to reduce the risk of seatbelt syndrome injuries. Some webbings have a fold sewn into them, with stitches that will break when a set amount of force is applied, allowing the person to move forward a little bit more. There is also the torsion bar, a length of metal attached to the rotating spool. This torsion bar is designed to twist and absorb some of the force from a crash, instead of allowing that energy to be transferred to the passenger's body. Despite the clear benefits of this three-point belt system, it took decades before the use of seatbelts really became widespread. Although Wisconsin was the first state to require all cars to install seatbelts in the front in 1961, it wasn't until 1984 that another state, New York, required passengers to actually wear them. I remember growing up in Ireland in the 90s and seeing this change in opinions about seatbelts in real time. And I especially remember moving to Malaysia, a country with a terrible road safety record, and where a friend of mine died because he wasn't wearing a seatbelt, and arguing with local co-workers who refused to wear them. The National Highway Traffic Safety Administration estimates 15,000 lives are saved by seatbelts every year in the US alone. So please put on your seatbelt. They do save lives. Of course, there are plenty of other devices helping to make cars safer. We have front and side airbags, crumple zones, driver assist, and emergency braking. And Volvo is now proposing a blanket-style seatbelt for its autonomous cars that would keep passengers safe and comfortable, even when they're napping. But that's still something of a pipe dream, since we're still a long way from self-driving cars. For now, we are stuck with the three-point harness, a simple and cheap device to keep passengers safe. Sometimes simple solutions really are the most effective. Other times, more complicated solutions are needed. One concept is so complicated that I struggle to wrap my head around it. I have a basic understanding of how computers work and a firm grasp of physics, but the physics of quantum computing goes right over my head. I wanted to start learning more about it in preparation for a future video, but my usual method of using college textbooks was not helping me. I didn't know what I didn't know, which makes asking the right questions really hard. Then I discovered that Brilliant has a new course on quantum computing, created in partnership with quantum computing researchers. It took me from the very basics of quantum computing, starting at a level I understand with basic logic gates, testing my understanding along the way, and explaining to me the correct answers in clear, understandable terms when I got something wrong. I regularly have to dive into the deep end of unfamiliar topics to write the scripts for this channel, and the most difficult part is usually knowing what questions to ask. But Brilliant removes that challenge with curated, guided courses designed to gradually level up your knowledge. You can take this course or one of Brilliant's many other courses, including our very own partnered course, by signing up to Brilliant's free trial with the link in the description, or by going to brilliant.org/realengineering. And if you found it valuable, which I'm sure you will, you can continue with 20% off the annual premium subscription. This offer is only available to the first 500 people to sign up. Brilliant teaches with interesting and fun interactive courses that challenge you along the way, making the learning process much easier and more rewarding. And they're adding more content monthly, so there's always something new to learn. You can get started for free by clicking the link on screen right now. And the first 500 people to do so will get 20% off Brilliant's annual premium subscription.